Let's talk about the vertebral column. It's made up of bones called vertebrae stacked on top of each other. And even though they look similar, they actually change shape and function depending on where you are in the spine. So the way we're going to understand the full anatomy of it is by first answering the questions how and why do we divide the spine into different regions? Why does the spine have curves? And what happens if those curves go wrong? Then we will look at the basic structures of the vertebrae, which is common across the majority of the vertebrae throughout the column. After that, we will talk specifically about the cervical vertebrae, thoracic vertebrae, lumbar vertebrae, and the sacrum and coccyx. What's up everyone? My name is Ty, I'm a medical doctor, and I make animated medical lectures to make different topics in medicine visually easier to understand. If you would like a PDF version or a quiz of this presentation, you can find it on my website, along with organized video lectures to help with your studies. Alright, let's get started. Look at this, the vertebral column, spine, backbone. This is the core part of the axial skeleton in vertebrates. It goes from your skull all the way down to the tailbone. And when you look at it, really just don't think anatomy right now, look at this. You will notice that at the top, it's much smaller. This is to not limit head, neck, and arm movement. As you go to the middle, the spine starts getting a little bit bigger, curved outwards. This is to hold the ribs and protect your thorax. A little bit down, it gets even bigger, large vertebrae responsible for holding the weight of the body and allows for a wide range of body motions. A little bit more down, and you will notice the bones are now fused into a shield-looking unit that hold a lot of our muscles that help us keep our body upright. Now, because the spine has different functions at different regions, we divide it into parts. We have 7 cervical vertebrae, 12 thoracic vertebrae, 5 fused sacral vertebrae, 5 fused sacral vertebrae, and 3 to 5 coccygeal vertebrae, averaging to about 4 coccygeal vertebrae in humans. This means that in humans, our spine is composed of 33 vertebrae. Now, let's analyze the spine a little bit more. This is really important. Why does your spine have curves? For this, let's put the spine back into the sky. In an upright position, we humans have physiological curvatures, and we divide them into primary curvatures and secondary curvatures. Primary curvatures are present in fetus and remain the same in adults. We call this type of curvatures kyphosis, outwards curvatures, which is normal to a certain degree. But it can be abnormal if it's exaggerated. These are the thoracic kyphosis and sacral kyphosis. The thoracic and sacral curvatures are termed primary curvatures because they are present in the fetus and remain the same in adults. As the child grows, lifts the head, and begins to assume an upright position, the secondary curvatures develop. These are known as lordosis, and you need to separate this term because a normal lordosis is a gentle inward curve. An abnormal lordosis, or also called hyperlordosis, is if the curve is too deep, causing lower back pain, muscle imbalances, postural issues, and so on. The cervical curve forms when the infant is able to hold his or her head at 3 or 4 months, and sit upright at 9 months. The lumbar lordosis forms between 12 and 18 months when the child begins to walk. Any exaggeration of these natural curves causes problems, and is often due to postural problems, muscle atrophy, or weakening of bones. Now, let's turn our guy to the front, turn on our x-ray machine, and then give him a little injury. If there is a lateral curve on the vertebral column, any wedging or rotation of the vertebrae, we call this condition scoliosis. So, that was the curvatures of the spine. Now, let's go ahead and remove the spine from the sky again. The vertebrae across different regions of the spine may differ, but the majority of them share some basic structure. And I want to remind you again, remember we got cervical vertebrae in the neck, we got vertebrae in the thorax, lumbar vertebrae, sacrum, and the coccyx. The majority of the vertebrae in the cervical region look like this. In the thoracic region, they look like this. And in the lumbar region, this is what they look like. Pay close attention now. They all have a vertebral body, they all have a vertebral arch, and they all have processes. This is really interesting. You see now they do have common basic structures, but notice they do differ slightly from one another depending on the function of that specific vertebrae. Let's look at these three structures in a little more detail. Focus on the vertebral body for a moment. Here we can see the intervertebral surface, which connects the intervertebral discs. Surrounding the surface is the annular epiphysis, which is a ring of compact bone on the external margin of the body containing a secondary ossification center. Now, let's move on to the vertebral arch. The vertebral arch is typically divided into two regions. It's the posterior part of the vertebral arch, called lamina, and the anterior narrowest part of the vertebral arch that connects to the vertebral body, called pedicle. Throughout all vertebrae in the spine, there is a large hole in the middle called the vertebral foramen, bordered by the body and the arch. Now, let's do the processes. The processes are simple. There's a spinous process that's pointing backwards, and it's the one you often can see and feel on a person's back. On the sides, we can see the transverse processes, which differs in size across the vertebrae, and we can see the superior and inferior articular processes. To understand these, let's look at the side view of the spine. The superior articular process is the bony part of the vertebrae that faces upwards and forms a joint with the vertebrae above, whereas the inferior articular process goes downwards and connects with the vertebrae below. When those vertebrae go together, they form the intervertebral foramen and the intervertebral canal. Why are they significant? Let me show you why. Within the vertebral canal is going to be a lot of different structures, and the noticeable ones are the spinal cord, as you see here, along with meninges around them. There are blood vessels, like the anterior and the posterior spinal arteries and the venous plexuses. There are ligaments, like the ligamentum flava and the posterior longitudinal ligament. Now, the spinal cord is going to give off some spinal nerves that unite to form the spinal nerve root that exit through the intervertebral foramen. Not of significance for the foramina here, but on this model, we can also see the sympathetic chain ganglia. Alright, what else can we see? Between the vertebral bodies of the spine, you will find intervertebral discs highlighted here in blue. They allow the vertebral column to be flexible and act as shock absorbers during activities. So, we saw that the vertebrae across the spine share some common basic structures, but there are specific structures that make vertebrae distinct based on where they are located. Most of the 7 cervical vertebrae share some specific structures, thoracic vertebrae has some specific structures for the ribs, lumbar vertebrae has some specific structures, and even the sacrum and coccyx. Now, the cervical vertebral column consists of 7 vertebrae and form the cervical lordosis. The cervical vertebrae generally share some morphological features across C3 to C7. The first cervical vertebrae, C1, is called atlas, and it greatly differs from the basic structures of the vertebrae, as it does not have a vertebral body. During development, its body fuses with the dents of the second cervical vertebrae, called atlas. Let's cover the specific features across the vertebrae. Now, if we look at the superior view of the normal cervical vertebrae, the first noticeable difference from a normal vertebrae is that the transverse process is different. It contains an extra hole here. This exists because the vertebral artery goes through it to supply the brain. A little side note here, on the transverse process of the 6th cervical vertebrae, there's an anterior tubercle, specifically called the carotid tubercle. This one is prominent and palpable in the neck, and clinically it's important because the common carotid artery can be compressed against it to control bleeding or check the pulse. That's why it's called the carotid tubercle. Alright. Other things we can see on the transverse process are the anterior tubercles, which are remnants of the cervical ribs, a posterior tubercle, and the groove for the spinal nerve. We can also see the articular processes. Superior articular process points dorsocranially, and the inferior articular process points ventrocaudally. And the spinous process is distinct here in this region as well, in that it's bifid, with the exception of C1 and C7. It is shaped this way because it increases the surface area for muscles and ligaments to attach, especially since neck muscles are involved in fine movement and posture. Now, let's do C1 atlas. For this one, let's start by looking at it from a superior view, as you see here. It will make sense in a moment. So what do we see? Remember we said that C1 greatly differs from the basic structures of the vertebrae as it does not have a vertebral body? Instead, it has an anterior and a posterior arch. There's a lateral mass, which contains the articular surfaces. And since we're looking at the superior view, we're looking at the superior articular surface, which articulates with the occipital condyle on the occipital bone. Usually, at the tip of the posterior end, we got a spinous process, right? Here we only got a posterior tubercle, which is the embryonic remnant of the spinous process and acts as the origin for the rectus capitis posterior minor and attachment for the nuchal ligaments. Anteriorly is the anterior tubercle, and on the inside of the arch is the facet for dens, which articulates with the dens of C2. There is one more structure we can't really see from this view, and it's a groove associated with the posterior arch. So if we go back to looking at the vertebral artery again, this artery actually winds around the posterior part of the lateral mass, forming the groove for the vertebral artery as it heads up to the brain, helping form the circle of Willis. Now, let's look at C2. Just for orientation, here is the anterior part, here is the posterior part. C2 axis is distinct in that it has dens that fits perfectly on the facet of C1. Now, this is really interesting. The reason why C2 has dens is that this is actually the embryonic remnant of the body of Atlas. Somewhere along the development, the body of C1 separated and fused with C2, giving an apex. And this resulted in C1 having just an arch on the anterior and posterior sides. This dens has an anterior articular facet, which articulates with the atlas, and posterior articular facet articulating with the transverse ligament of atlas. So that was the cervical vertebrae. Now, let's do the specific structures associated with the thoracic vertebrae. The thoracic vertebrae consists of 12 vertebrae and forms the thoracic kyphosis. Thorax has ribs, right? Because the ribs are connected with the thoracic vertebrae, they restrict the movements of the thoracic vertebral column. Now, we divide the thoracic vertebrae into typical vertebrae, usually 2nd to 9th, and atypical vertebrae, which are T1, T10, T11, and T12. The typical vertebrae is distinct because it has a superior costal facet, inferior costal facet, and a transverse costal facet. The superior and transverse facet both provide a point of attachment for the same rib, while the inferior facet is usually for the rib below. So, this is the typical, general, usual thoracic vertebrae. Why do we have atypical vertebrae? This is a very subtle difference, but T1 is atypical because it has a single full facet for the head of the first rib, and it has an inferior demifacet for the head of the second rib. And just morphologically, T1 bears some resemblance to the lower cervical vertebrae. For the other atypical ones, T9 is highly variable. Some sources mention it as atypical as well, just because it might not have an inferior demifacet. But generally, T10 to T12 are the main ones. T10 has a single full facet, while T11 and T12 both have a single full facet, while also the facet on the transverse process is rudimentary. So, those are the specific features of the thoracic vertebrae. The lumbar vertebral column consists of 5 large vertebrae that share morphological characteristics and form the lumbar lordosis. These vertebrae are huge, have a strong body, and processes that support the weight of the body. There's a lot of heavy stress on the lower back as you move, so these bones have to be able to support that. The specific thing here is that the transverse processes are less well developed on the lumbar vertebrae. They rather have something called costal processes, which are the lumbar equivalent of the ribs. So they are the embryonic remnant of the lumbar ribs. Otherwise, the body is tall, wide, and kidney-shaped, and the spinous process is flat and quadrate-shaped when viewed from the side. So that was the lumbar vertebral column. Now, let's do the sacrum and coccyx. These are interesting. The sacrum is formed by fusion of 5 sacral vertebrae. The coccyx consists of 3 to 5 fused rudimentary vertebrae, very variable. They form the sacral kyphosis. Let's isolate them. Again, here we see that there were initially 5 sacral vertebrae that fused. So how do we generally divide the sacrum? We have the base at the top and an apex at the bottom, connecting to the coccyx via an intervertebral disc. The base, if you look here, has a promontory, which is a part of the terminal line of the pelvis, and we got the superior articular processes, which articulates with the corresponding inferior articular processes of the 5th lumbar vertebrae. From this view, we can also see the sacral wing. These are the lateral parts of the sacrum and contain the auricular surfaces, which articulates with the ilium. And if we look at the backside, we can see the sacral tuberosity, which serves as the attachment for the posterior sacroiliac ligament. Alright, what else can we see? On the pelvic surface, we can see the anterior sacral foramina, which are four pairs of openings that transmit the anterior rami of the sacral spinal nerves. And we can see the transverse ridges. Those are lines that form due to the fusion of vertebrae. Now, let's look at the sacrum from a posterior view. Here we can see the posterior sacral foramina, which are four pairs of openings that transmit the posterior branches of the sacral spinal nerves, S1 to S4. Apart from this, we can also see the lateral sacral crest, which is due to the fusion of the transverse process, median sacral crest due to fused spinous processes, and the medial sacral crest due to fusion of the articular processes. Within the sacrum, there's a canal called the sacral canal. This is an extension of the vertebral canal, and it goes all the way down to open at the sacral hiatus, transmitting the spinal nerves S5 and the coccygeal nerve. This opening is bordered laterally by the sacral horns, which are remnant of the articular processes. Now, coccyx. This small tailbone is the end of the vertebral column. It's highly variable between people, but in average, there are four vertebrae here that fused and made this bone. If we turn it around, we can see something called coccygeal corneae, which are horns pointing cranially and a remnant of the articular processes. So that was all I had for the bones of the vertebral column. The vertebral column don't work alone. They are connected by a network of ligaments and membranes that stabilize it during movement and help prevent injuries. And interestingly, a lot of back problems start right here, with the ligaments. If you want to understand how these ligaments are arranged and what they do, check out the next video and I'll see you there. If you want handmade PDF version of this lecture, take a quiz to test your knowledge, or access an organized list of all my videos, you can find everything on my website. Thanks for watching, see you next one.